3, 2, 1.
Why are you looking at us?
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Strength Students Podcast. I'm your co-host, Steve Carty.
I'm your other co-host, Nick Scopoletti.
And we're back here with John Durrett.
Yeah, hi, guys.
John Durrett.
Johnny!
Is back. Now he's on camera, too. You can see his ass.
Well, his face.
His chest ass face.
Turn out.
And John's joining us from episode, what was the first
12.
Episode? 12. Episode 12.
On micronutrients.
Episode 12. Talked about micronutrients, so.
Most popular episode.
Yeah.
One of the most.
If you don't remember who John is, go check
now
that out.
Now there's a video, so it won't be popular anymore. Like,
oh, no.
That's what that fucking guy looks like.
So we're here today talking to John Durrett, nutrition expert about eating for strength.
Not okay. Exaggeration at all.
Eating for strength.
That's good.
So, a lot of information out there, as always. A lot of myths, a lot of things you could do right, a lot of things you could do wrong. So, we're with John Durrett today to dispel some myths.
Mm-hmm.
Also, talk about maybe how you're eating for strength wrong. Are you eating for strength the right way? What's going on? Is it different?
Do you just eat a box of donuts, then you go lift?
Yeah.
Or? Well,
exactly.
I mean, some folks think that. You know, that's one of the things that's out there.
I need an inter workout Pop Tart every time I lift.
Yeah, how do you feel about that?
The Pop Tarts?
Yeah, like that, like donuts.
Not in
while
general,
you lift,
just like for strength
when you lift, all that. Give us the rundown of that.
So, I mean, so there is a very select group of people that's okay for.
Like who?
If your sport is just not Steve.
Okay.
If your sport is just powerlifting, and I guess for like some hard gainer bodybuilders. Mm. Then maybe there's some wiggle room for stuff like donuts and Pop-Tarts and things like that. And, you know, in if you're counting your macros, I guess you can argue there's room for it. But as we talked about in the last episode, I'd always say, like, Pop-Tarts aren't good for you.
Right.
You know, they're a high-calorie food, but they have low nutrient input. So it's sort of like I think of those foods as thrifty foods, right? There's a lot of calorie there, but not a lot of nutritious value. So if I'm trying to get, my body wants to perform the best it can, again, recapping the last episode a lot here, but if I'm trying to get the best I can out of my performance, I could get those calories somewhere else with a better nutrient profile that would help support my activity levels. So that's generally a better, now, again, where is it good? We're talking about getting strong. If I have a power lifter and he's in like an open weight category,
mm-hmm.
like let's, you know, take the reins off a little bit. This guy can get big, you know.
Yeah.
Or you're super high weightlifters. Your heavyweight's there too. But you know, a lot of folks. I'm going on a limb here. A lot of folks listening to this, and a lot of strength athletes in general, are not going to be that super heavyweight category. In fact, a large number of strength athletes have to make weight for a competition.
Yeah, there's not many people walking around like 270 plus that are like, you know, lifting the, like, there's not that many people, like
right.
average person.
And even those guys, so, and then here's my argument, with the exception of maybe like a dude who's like a super hard gainer who's trying to get big, almost every person who is out there crushing donuts could be doing better if that was like rice or pasta, you know, as opposed to just something as bad for you as a donut. And we also get this issue of, you know, if we want to get into insulin sensitivity, right, that becomes a huge factor on folks who are crushing all these super simple carbs. I mean, it's not good for your overall health long term either.
And would you say, like, when you say overall health, are you talking about, like, say you eat something sugary and that causes inflammation, then you're doing training, which also causes a different type of inflammation, and
right.
it just stacks on top of each other?
Yeah, good point.
Is that what you mean, like, when you talk about that type of stuff?
Well, I'm talking about, like, quality of life.
Okay.
But you're not wrong at all. You're actually that's another sort of bullet to hit on the list, right? If your body is combating super hard to
right.
recover from these workouts, you're doing your body a disservice by creating additional inflammation from these high inflammatory foods.
Right.
So not a great pick.
So you're just almost like slathering layers of inflammation on when you're eating like this.
Right. And it's sort of the idea of, like, you know, and the funniest thing you see And this is where I get in like a more heated exchange with a lot of these guys who count macros. Mm-hmm. Is like they'll post a photo of their breakfast and it's like, counting my macros, I'm having donuts and fish oil. And it's like,
like it's my favorite combo.
Well, I mean, like, but like, all right, so you're like that fish oil is not even going to counteract the fucking donut. Right. Like it's not even enough to like to combat that. So if you're this kind of person, we'll talk about supplements in a second, but if you're this kind of person who's addressing things with like inflammation, you should be addressing it. You should be taking a full-on approach, not just sort of like, oh well, let me take my fish oil or my turmeric or whatever. Mm-hmm. or my Advil, whatever you're on to sort of cut inflammation.
Right.
And then also you're putting the food you're taking in is another drug. And that drug is causing inflammation, you know? So that's a huge thing a lot of folks get caught on.
It's almost like a traffic jam, and like that shitty food that you're putting in your body is like just causing more of a traffic jam.
It's like another car on the pileup, man.
Exactly.
Just driving really hard into that.
So take us into physiologically why that's kind of a route you don't want to go, like eating the donuts and the Pop-Tarts during lifts. Like everyone will say like, oh man, like I'm my anabolic window or I'm training. So it's all just getting used as fuel right now. So it's all good. So, what's the physiological difference between like, all right, I'm going to smash these donuts when I lift, or I'm going to have, whether it be like a carb supplement or
great question.
I'm going to eat like a banana or an apple while I lift.
So banana and apple, also both bad choices. If we're talking intra-workout.
Intra-workout.
But it's fruit, John.
Yes. How about pre?
Huh?
How about pre?
Pre. Well, let's go intra first, and then we'll go pre.
Okay.
So for intra-workout, you have to, your best bet intra-workout is like maybe some aminos, depending on how long your session is.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking, if your session's going to last, and these are some of our high-level lifters, or CrossFitters, whatever your group is. If we're talking high-level athlete, and they're going 2 hours nonstop, again, as a coach, I'd be like, hey, take a break, get a meal. But if you don't have time, you know, busy people trying to be successful in their sport,
right?
You know, then maybe some aminos if we're going 2 hours or longer.
Intra, you're talking about,
yes.
Still.
Yep. And a carb source. And the reason we want the powdered carb source, outside of like, I mean, you're looking at that or like honey if you want to go natural,
mm-hmm.
but you need something your body can actually use. If I eat that apple or that banana, it's not. So if I, let's say I'm a 2 hour workout.
Yeah, as you were saying. So it's basically a principle of like absorption.
Right.
Absorption.
So if I'm in a 2 hour workout and I eat an apple, especially apple is a great example because it's so fibrous.
Right.
If I eat that apple an hour into my workout, it's not even going to hit my body until my workout's over.
Right.
So it'll help recovery. Like post workout, but it's not going to do a damn thing for me in that second window.
So then what about, someone might come to you and say, okay, well then something like a Pop-Tart or donut, like I'll be able to use that immediately.
It absorbs faster, but it's still not fast enough.
You're talking things like for like a carb supplement, like you think like waxy maize, stuff
yeah,
like that.
Yeah. Something like that. Or okay. Even like a powdered glucose.
Okay.
Or like the glucose gels.
Gotcha. Okay.
That's where they have their place, you know, is in that, the one thing I go to when I do, if I know I have a competition or like a longer session, or like even like a lifting meet, like the Cliff bars makes these little gel bricks.
Okay.
And like, I think like three of them is like the serving, like six to a box and take a glass of water with that. And it's just like a gel glucose. And that gets in you
straight,
super quick.
Straight glucose.
Oh, right. I mean, your body absorbs it in like 15, 20 minutes. It's really quick.
Yeah, so you don't have to break it down to glucose.
Right.
It's just glucose.
So if you have a multi-event day, right, if you're a power lifter and you have, all right, well, you know, my one lift's out of the way and my second lift is coming up,
mm-hmm.
and you say to, I mean, a lot of powerlifting meets are super slow, but if you had like a faster, if you had a bit of a clip there, it really helps to get that in.
Word. Okay. So... why is it then that there are a lot of these athletes, I guess particularly in the strength field now, all of a sudden, like past couple of years, it's been like there's literally companies, donuts and deadlifts, like it's been integrated so much and they're like, oh, we can eat this now, which I think is good from a healthy relationship with food standpoint.
Yeah.
It's not the industry of old where it's like, eat clean until you die and don't ever put anything bad in your body. It's like, okay. But now I feel like it's getting a little nuts. Like,
absolutely.
But how are these athletes still performing highly with all these like shitty foods coming in?
I mean, so,
or do they just know they're not as performing as well as they could be?
That would be my argument, that an athlete can do just fine. Cause right. You know, again, listen to episode 12. if you have your base macros, your body has what it needs. But, right? So, like, why does Katrin David's daughter, you know, the fittest woman on earth from CrossFit 2 years in a row, bring prepared meals
to like five-star restaurants?
You don't really see her like, oh, ripping donuts today.
No.
Like,
never. You never would.
No.
Never.
You never would.
I don't think Bergeron would allow it.
I don't think he would tell her not to.
Or working against gravity.
Honestly, I don't think he would tell her not to. I think he would say whatever works for you.
Mm-hmm. Kind of right, if it ain't broke.
Right, exactly. Well, you've won twice, so.
Keep it up.
Yeah.
I've had personal experiences where I did a little experimenting with like, I'm going to eat like Pop-Tarts while I lift, because it's like, I'm eating it while I lift, so it's almost like nothing's going through my body. It's just straight absorption. And I did that for a couple months, and I just, like, my body composition absolutely changed. Even though I was training,
absolutely
doing comp training, competition training for CrossFit, I was doing weightlifting, all that, but I was just, like, pudgier in some places. I wasn't as fat, I wasn't as light and as fast and as quick as on my feet as I am now.
And let's even think about this idea of I'm trying to get stronger. I want to get stronger, right? Then the only thing you need, I mean, you should be eating a balanced diet, but if we're talking about workout, pre-workout, inter-workout, post-workout, the thing you need your carbs for is just to drive activity. So if your carbs aren't effectively doing that job, they are useless in that window of the day. Mm. If they're not, if your post or pre-workout carbs are not doing something that's going to help you perform in the workout, they're useless. Right. And there are some foods that would take, like, so if you ate like, I mean, it's a horrible example. I don't know why you would do this, but if you ate like a lot of broccoli, the broccoli is not going to get into your system for like 2 hours, 2.5 hours. Right. Just based on the digestion.
Pre-workout
times.
Broccoli.
It's a horrible plan.
We should start a supplement company.
If you want to really suck at working out. So that's a big thing, right? Is this idea of people come to me a lot, say, hey, coach, what should I eat before workout? And ideally I want them eating 90 minutes to 2 hours beforehand and just eating something that they enjoy. That's a healthy, balanced meal. Right. And then your intra workout, again, if they're not training 2 hours or longer, I don't think you need an intro. And I think people come to this idea where, man, and isn't it so tempting? Like, oh, there's this powder you can take that will make you a better athlete. Oh fuck. I've been working hard. Why I take a powder? That's great. Right. Like that's not the way it works. And so that's something the industry is built around that. It's built around convincing people, you know, like you guys probably know guys like this, you know, athletes get phone calls. Hey, will you sponsor our product that you don't take?
Right.
Sure. And that creates the illusion. You know, Siobhan, a few of her, she's a regionals athlete who's been on the podcast before. For
episode 5.
That's early. Yeah.
Single digits.
But, so like she's got a bunch of sponsors and a lot of them found her. She didn't go to them and say like, hey,
that's how it usually goes.
Right. Yeah. So a lot of times we get this image of these supplements as like this thing that's going to make you better. Mm-hmm. And it was never something that helped someone to begin with, you know? So again, if they're intra workout and it's a longer workout, then I would throw not protein. It's a big mistake. I don't care if it's whey, egg, doesn't matter.
You're
not protein.
Intra workout.
During the workout. Not a good plan.
Why not?
Digestion. And we'll talk about in a second about maybe this will be like a little bit later, but there's a difference between like eating to get strong, eating to stay strong, eating to build muscle. Those are all like slightly different strategies. Mm. And whey protein falls into that getting stronger, but also getting bigger. I talk to a lot of clients and they say, hey, I'm trying to lean out. And it's like the first thing I say is, well, then no more protein shakes. And people are like, what? My protein? Like, well, yeah, but that's people drink that to gain mass.
Yeah.
If you're trying to lean out and you're drinking protein shakes, like unless it's like, and I don't believe in meal replacements, but unless that's what you're doing with it, you're counteracting that goal again. Plus, that's the fish oil and the donut again.
As much as whey is derived from, you know, whatever, it could be clean as, but it's not as clean as like food. You know what I'm saying?
Or
there's other things in there like, oh, my chocolate, Rocky Road tasting whey. It's all natural though. It's like, there's some shit going on in there.
It tastes like birthday cake and childhood.
Right. It's like, exactly.
Oh, it's so good. Rocky Road doesn't fucking grow in the backyard. Like, not all natural.
You'd have a Rocky Road tree in your backyard as a kid.
So the cleanest thing you can take are those aminos.
Right.
And they're going to get right in there. And what they really do intra-workout is they sort of right? Intra-workout, post-workout, what we're really looking at doing is, well, intra-workout more so, we're trying to fight muscle wasting, right? And sort of the helping, so the muscles are breaking down. Mm-hmm. I want to get nutrients to those muscles as soon as possible to help them build up. Those are my amino acids. That's what they're used for.
Build up,
you know? Exactly. Yeah, everyone, the textbook, right? We all remember that from, I didn't go to school. But
I need school, man.
All right, and then so another myth that we could kind of transition onto here is, hey, I want to eat to get bigger and stronger. Oh, okay, you don't really need to watch what you eat. Just eat everything in sight and just eat as much as you can no matter what. What's the deal with that?
For some clients, that's true. And I think I might have told this story in the last podcast, but I have this vivid memory of one of my favorite guys to work with. We turned him in. He like started training as like, he was a D1 sprinter. So, you know, explosive, strong kid, but like tiny. And we turned him into like the Incredible Hulk. He gained like 30 or 40 pounds. No, he got, and like six pack, like jacked and ripped. There's a photo somewhere before and after of him like running in the rain, like bony, and then him pushing a sled in the rain out here, like jacked out
of control. Why was he always in the rain?
I don't know, right?
It's a weird theme.
Because he lives in the Northeast. I remember this phone call. I was writing his meal plans, and nothing was working. We could not get him to gain weight. And so I started saying, like, look to you, like, you need to go out and eat. And then, like, after you eat, like, you need to eat some more. And like when you feel like you want to vomit, you've finally had enough. And so he literally, and you know, this is torture. He ate till he wanted to vomit like three times a day, four times a day. And then he also had snacks, you know? Awesome. And I remember one night he called me and it was fucking like, it was amazing. Like 8 o'clock at night, he calls me. He's like, I can't drink this milkshake. And I'm like,
oh yeah, you did tell the story.
It's like, it's you amazing. Have to. You have to do it. He's like, I can't. And I was like, pick it up, man. We can do this. Drink this milkshake. So I'm coaching this kid through drinking like a chocolate milkshake.
He's on the edge of a building somewhere. Yeah. Like, this protein shake just waving back and forth.
And so with him, we had to be a little bit, but he still ate relatively healthy, right? He got his servings of vegetables in a day. You know, I mean, he wasn't completely, it can't be like, you know, chicken nugs and like Frosties, right? You have to have you have to have a bit of structure there because, like we talked about last time, your body needs all those micronutrients to support growth and exercise.
Mm-hmm.
And I think where a lot of folks are very quick. So let's talk about what a hard gainer is, right? A hard gainer is a guy who's, everyone knows that beanpole kid, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, the kid who was like, you know, got tall really early on or got really tall later
basketball
in high
players.
School. Yeah, but like some basketball players aren't hard gainers. But some of them, the lanky guys who got super tall.
Most of them
like,
are, yeah.
Yeah, those are your hard gainers. And sometimes you have a short, like the guy I was talking about a second ago, shorter athlete, so you can see him shorter. But these are guys where like they're eating 3,000 calories, 4,000 calories a day, and they're not even gaining weight. That's a hard gainer. And that's the person who like, all right, bro, let's get some milkshakes.
Right.
You know, let's get some burgers.
Yeah,
right.
My favorite example of a hard gainer is Brandon Lilly. If you guys know who he is.
Yeah, I saw his picture.
You see, when he was in college, he was tiny.
Dude.
And he eats. I went to one of his seminars, and I've never seen a human being do this. He had a bag he carried around with him of McDonald's hamburgers.
Oh, my God.
And he ate them like potato chips. He would, like, root through the bag and be like, you know, give you the great cue, and he'd be jumping on this, like, hamburger. And he'd reach up for another hamburger, and I was like, oh, my God.
It's like pulling them out of his pockets.
Another dude like that who I saw recently, I think, somewhere on Instagram was Lane Norton. He posted like a throwback picture of him. I think he was a track guy, sprinter, or something like that.
He was very skinny in high school.
Super skinny. Now, you know, he's gigantic now. But it's just crazy.
A lot of those guys are
species to the other species.
But a lot of those guys are such special cases because they started so much one way and then they wanted to go so much in the other direction. And most of your clients, most of the athletes you work with, don't want to go there. And if you're, so when I was at a collegiate spectrum back when I worked at Trinity, none of my athletes needed to go there except for like two kids on the football team and like one basketball player, again, who were hard gainers. Mm. And that was it. But like, I don't like, no tennis player needs to look like Arnold Schwarzenegger and it's not going to help them.
Right.
It's not. they're going to be worse.
Right.
So that's a big misconception there. Okay. It's for a very select group.
Where does the role, we talk a lot about carbohydrates and sugars and proteins. Where does the role of fat play in strength? Because you always hear people talk about insulin's the most anabolic hormone. You know, that's the most anabolic, but so is testosterone. And if you don't eat enough fat, like that takes care of your hormones. So where does that come into play as far as like fat intake for strength?
Fat's huge for strength athletes, and not just testosterone hormonal control is great,
right?
But fat is the food for your brain too.
Okay.
You know, in a big way. And what we tend to forget is so much of strength is not muscular, but neuromuscular.
Okay.
And you have to feed that as well.
Right.
As far as from a really practical standpoint, fat does a great job of controlling, I always pronounce this word wrong, but satiety, you know, like being satiated.
Satiety.
Feeling full. You know, if you're super hungry and you grab like a handful of cashews, you might be like, oh, I feel pretty good. Fiber does the same thing, right?
Right.
You eat an apple, like, oh, I'm okay. Whereas if it was like, oh, I'm going to eat some rice. Oh, four bowls of rice later, I need some more rice.
I could eat rice.
Yeah.
Exactly, right?
Like, oh my God.
But there's nothing to it. It's just glucose.
Right.
So that's why.
Word. I could fucking eat rice forever.
Another myth that may or may not still be debated now. Are you getting stronger in the gym when you're working out? Or are you getting stronger when you're not in the gym?
I hope that's not still debated. No, you only get stronger... arguably you get weaker when you're in the gym, and it's only
technically, yeah.
Right.
Technically, you're just.
I always tell
an
people,
hour of you breaking your body down.
I tell people, right, I was right. Like, you're not building shit right now. You are not building any muscle at this moment. They're like, what do you mean? I'm working out. It's like, no, you're tearing it apart.
Yeah.
What are the other 23 hours? What are you doing?
Exactly. That's why nutrition's so important, and sleep and things like that. You're not getting any stronger lifting weight. Breaking some hearts here. But you get stronger when you're not in the gym. And I'll tell you guys, man, like if you have a client who's not getting stronger, take some of their volume away. Yeah. Take some of their sets away because they're not recovering.
Right.
And then they, oh, wow, look, I just PR'd four times. We had a bunch of people here who were on our comp training program.
Mm-hmm.
And we put them on like a comp training B program that was like half the volume. And suddenly they went from being like run down to like crushing.
Oh yeah,
weights,
absolutely.
Crushing endurance workouts, crushing edges. Their body just could not recover well enough.
Mm-hmm. And so, I guess that could depend on the person.
Oh,
like
absolutely.
For me personally, when I was injured in a way, and not doing like the high volume of like competitive training and taking classes every day and weightlifting all the time and all that, I took all that time away, continued to move and do a lot of recovery, and PR'd everything when I came back.
Yep, and part of it's going to be age. Part of it's going to be genetics.
Right.
Part of it's training background.
So many different parts of the pie, yeah.
There's a lot of stuff that affects your... again, we talked about the guys from Renaissance Periodization last time I was here, briefly.
Yeah.
They just wrote a really cool series of articles on your MRV, maximum recoverable volume, and how it's super different for everybody. And when you work with like master's athletes, you know, people who are in their 40s, 50s, so on and so forth, they the amount of volume it would take, the reason we get weaker, they believe, this is the theory they assert, the reason we get weaker as we get older is the amount of volume it would take for us to get better is higher than we're able to recover from because of our age.
Okay.
And that's why you begin to decline in strength.
That makes
interesting.
Sense.
Okay.
It's an interesting theory for sure.
Yeah. Okay. All right, guys, we're going to take a quick break. And when we come back, we are going to talk about the things now that you can be doing right in order to eat for strength and what you should be eating and all that good stuff.
Totally.
So we're going to take a quick break. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Are we just going to wave? Is that?
Want more of the Strength Students Podcast? Go check us out on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. Also, make sure you leave us a 5-star review on iTunes and on Stitcher. Stitcher, I just met her.
Welcome back, Strength Students Podcast.
What the fuck is that?
John Durrett.
Steve Carney works at the airport, apparently.
I thought this was a magic show. And we're back with John Durrett. We're talking about how to eat for strength. Something that seems so simple, yet can be so confusing.
Well, I think even though it's rudimentarily simple, right, there's the way to go about it that a lot of folks do, which, you know, like your bro at the gym says, like, oh, just like, you know, pound down some more food, bud. And it's like, all right, great. Or you could scientifically approach it and really sort of make a plan for success.
Mm.
So here's the first thing. First things first, if you're eating to gain strength, right?
Yeah. So let's start there.
Right.
All right. someone's sitting at home.
Number one.
They're like, all right, man, I'm ready. I'm ready to eat for strength. Where do I start? Where do you start with something?
Wait, we're going
to
gain weight. That's the first place. And people don't want to hear that.
Well, we're going to gain that baby weight.
Well, the question is, can I get stronger without gaining weight? Yes, but that's going to take years, plural, and not like one or two, like several. So that's a big
a
thing.
A decade.
All right, so
it
why?
It can take a long time.
Yeah. All right, why?
There's a few different elements to that. Partly, so like mass moves mass. So we talked about you don't get stronger in the gym, but if you move more weight, you will get stronger when you recover because your body is adapting to a greater stimulus. So even though you're not getting stronger in the gym, if you do, so like that's where creatine has a good place. That's the one place that pre-workouts have a good place. If they're helping you move more weight, they're tremendously helpful for gaining strength. Which, you know, creatine, beta-alanine, different pre-workout blends for different people, all work well there. Caffeine, you know,
solid one,
right? If you can move more weight, you're gonna do better there. But also, if you're eating to stay. So most folks who are eating they're worried about being lean, right? If they're, oh, I don't want to gain weight and be strong. That's secret code talk for, well, I still want a six pack. That's what it is. It's not, right. They're not saying I want to stay doughy. They're saying I want to be shredded and stronger. That's what that code word talk is there. And your body needs to eat like it's trying to gain weight in order to recover for that really, really high level strength movement, right? If you're really pushing your body to the max on pure strength movement stuff, right? It's not for CrossFitters necessarily here, but we're talking about people, weightlifters, powerlifters, bodybuilders, people who are strongmen, people who are really trying to get strong, right? Then your body has, in order to recover well enough, you have to eat so you're gaining weight. And that's just, and then here's the important part, right? So this is where the gym bro is sort of like not your best friend. I mean, maybe he is, it's fine, but he's not going to help you with this. So what we want to do is, so your body needs to eat 3,000 calories in excess of its daily load. Mm-hmm. To gain a pound of weight.
Oh.
Okay.
Timeout.
Word.
Really? That's like a...
That's scientific fact.
So 3,000 calories.
So when I was really, really fat and I ate 32 ounces of peanut butter in a single sitting, I gained like 3 pounds right there.
How the fuck did you... How?
Endurance.
Peanut butter. a will to win.
Dude.
It's really... Peanut butter is delicious. I just ate it.
It is, but 32 ounces? Yeah.
Like that big
shit. That's my fucking water bottle that I just
that's
fucked up.
So that's fucked up. One spoonful at a time, man. That's how you do it.
That's how you bulk, man.
I was 315 pounds, man. I was huge
of pure muscle.
So say you burn 2500 calories at rest, right? That's your
exactly right. So we have
3000 above that,
right?
Okay,
so if your basal metabolic rate for people who don't know at home, that's the amount of calories you burn at rest per day.
Your baseline.
So that's without working out.
That's just chilling.
Right? So that if you need to exceed that base, this is why it's so crazy people get obese until you see how many calories are in a Big Mac, but you have to be in excess of your daily basal metabolic rate by 3,000 calories to gain a pound. Now, we're not looking to gain a pound a day. That's a great path to poor health and poor performance.
Okay.
We're looking to gain like maybe like 2, maybe 4 pounds a month.
Okay.
So you want to structure that person's diet and their meal plan.
So a pound a week.
Essentially, yes. So, right, some simple math there. It's like 300 to 500 calories a day.
I was going to say, okay, like.
Right, in excess of what they need to fund their activity.
Okay.
So, right, this idea of bulking, oh, I need to like eat like 3,000 eggs a day. Right, the Gaston diet for Beauty and the Beast, you know? 6 dozen
eggs.
That's
what Steve does.
I'm going to eat a human person.
So there is something too. If you want to get strong fast, right, and you're willing to get like fat, there that is a thing you can do.
I've done that.
You can eat a lot and get strong a little bit, but you'll suffer in other areas.
If we're
looking to gain a little bit, right, then we can just jack that calorie output a little bit. And what I do with folks who, I think my trade secret here, if I'm not building a meal plan for someone and they're just like, look, tell me how to get, so here's the big spoiler, right? I want to get stronger. What do I do? Write down everything you're eating. Step one. Step two, be okay eating, if you're serious, be okay eating those foods every day. Now increase, you're weighing and measuring everything. Increase your measurements by about 20%. And see what happens.
Okay. Step four, I like that. Eat 32 ounces of peanut butter in one sitting.
Perfect. And then, right, so then we're just adding a little bit to the meals there. We're not going so far ahead.
Which, like you said, you could do that. You could just, like, go 5,000 calories a day.
But you run
but
a lot of risks
there. In other areas.
You run a lot of risks there.
But like I said, I've been there before, too, where I'm like, all right, I'm going to get big and strong. And I just ate everything in sight.
Like, but if you feel like garbage,
nausea, like
if you feel like garbage, are you going to perform well?
Right. Exactly.
It depends on the person.
And I got stronger, and I gained muscle, but I also gained a lot of fat.
Yeah.
My athletic ability went down. Mm. Like my stamina, I was having like
dude, you were
like cardiac problems when I was trying to sleep. Like,
and so
I was breathing. Like, right. I was like terrible.
For some athletes,
and I'm a hard gainer.
For some athletes, that's a discussion to have, right? Are we going to be fat for a while? A great way to see if a strength athlete's on steroids or not, see if they ever get fat. Mm. If they keep getting stronger, like stronger and stronger and stronger and stronger, and they never get fat, they're probably taking some drugs. Mm. That's probably like, oh, dude, my friend Jim, you know, he's had six packs forever, and his bench has gone up 100 pounds in a year. He's on steroids.
Mm. There's like, I think it was,
he's on drugs.
I think it was like Mark Bell that said, like, if like you're 200 or if you're over 220 or something like that, and you're under 10% body fat,
you're probably
chances
on
are.
That's like his,
unless you're like 6'4", So, but that's a great sort of thing to talk about with an athlete.
Okay.
Or do you want to get fat? Is strength? So this is my sophomore football player. Like, coach, I want to be on the line. I want to get in the game. Yep. All right. You talked about that in a podcast one time, one of your coaches, right?
Don't bring it up. Don't bring it up.
But that's the discussion to have. It's like, all right, well, if you want that position and you have 2 years left to play, well, now time is an element we have to play with.
Okay.
Are you willing? And it's different for different athletes. For a CrossFitter, it might be like, all right, well, so I'm coughing a lot today. If in this part of your season, maybe we carry a little bit of dough, you know, and I think she's gorgeous, but Camille is famous for that. Camille LeBlanc will put on a little bit of weight, and you'll see during parts of the year, she doesn't have abs anymore because she's a natural non-steroid taking. I would assume, I don't know, but I would assume she's not on steroids because she definitely for parts of the year works on her lifts, gains a little bit of weight, but then like, and you've seen, if you watch the CrossFit games, she missed her timing once.
Yeah.
She went to the games and she was still doughy. Mm. And other years she goes to the games shredded and crushed. She won 1 year. Fittest woman on earth.
Mm. Yeah.
Right. But she times that nutrition well. So that's one way to do it. And it's all about knowing the numbers.
So before we transition away from calories, what's the best way to find out, hey, what's my basal
metabolic rate?
Basal metabolic rate.
It's tough. There's certain formulas you can use.
Based off what? Like height,
weight, age.
Okay.
Eye color, blood type, hair length.
Okay.
Fingernails. That's it. But they're all going to be ballpark.
Okay.
And that's where it comes in. That's why it's good to have a coach to work with for nutrition, because then you can, instead of being like, well, this isn't working, let me go to the donuts. Like, hey, coach, I'm not seeing I'm seeing too little results, too much result.
Mm-hmm.
You know, well, we were supposed to gain 2 pounds this week. I gained 6.
Okay.
All right. Then we know that there was something wrong with our calculations there.
So what are some of the, do you know any specific formulas offhand?
There, you can like Google search like basal metabolic rate formula. Something comes up.
There is, I know I've done.
There's a calculator too, I think, online.
There's I did like the in-body scan where it tells you your body fat. So tells you, I've done that. So, and it said I was at 2000 and then I did the machine where I'm actually breathing into it for 20 minutes or so. And it tells you and I was 400 over. That was 2,400 at rest. That's more accurate. And the guess was 2,000. So you are playing.
Exactly. And there, you can do a body scan. It's generally a little expensive. There's a place in town here that does them. It's pretty nice. And I've done one there. And it's good to have. But the toughest thing with the formula is, all right, so am I a 200-pound 20% body fat? Or am I a 200-pound 8% body fat athlete? So that's going to change a lot.
Yeah. Oh yeah, okay.
Changed a lot.
Big so deal. Kind of transitioning from calories now. So that's like the caloric side of things.
Right.
Now how should your plate look? Like, what's more important? Should I be eating protein all the time, carbs all the time? Like, what should your plates look like and when should they look like that?
Yeah, I've gone over a lot of theories over the years on that. and stuff that's worked and not worked for different clients. I would, and you know, like my personal diet's like super weird. I'm always vegetarian before I train.
Mm-hmm.
And then I eat meat afterwards.
That's interesting.
My body doesn't process meat well. I don't know what it is.
So no protein. Eggs maybe before?
I can eat eggs. Vegetarian, not vegan.
Right.
I'll do yogurts, eggs.
I don't know all these fucking subcategories.
But then when you train, after you train?
I can eat meat. Yeah.
Okay. And so when you train like middle of the day or something like that?
Yeah. That's why I train in the middle of the day. And it sort of varies for me. Like,
that's so interesting.
I can eat like some lean meats and be okay. But like anything heavy, like red meat, I'm done. And if it's a strength day, I can eat whatever I want. This is talking about CrossFit.
Yeah.
Being able to have the engine work.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay.
But for most athletes, what I generally tell folks to do is, it depends on when you train the day, right? If you're an early morning person, you're in for a tough, tough ride as far as getting stronger.
Yeah, fuck that morning. I don't get it. I never got it.
for a morning person, I would say you don't want to go in the gym empty if you're trying to get stronger. If you're trying to lose weight, there's some science behind that, going in empty, doing that kind of stuff.
Yeah, sure.
But if you're trying to get strong, you should never be empty, right? You should be eating consistently.
Yeah, absolutely.
But definitely going to the gym. So let's say this is your morning crowd, right? I would tell them, look, man, like now this is when we get a shake, right? Get a shake, get some carbs, get some aminos in, go in. And why? Because we need that to fuel the performance, mm-hmm. right? And then the rest of their day, if they're really trying to get strong, their second job, if they're an accountant, they're also an accountant who's trying to gain weight. That's like their second job. And they need to eat. And I try to keep it as clean as possible. I try to keep it lean, lean meat sources. Try to keep like nuts and seeds, vegetables, you know, some fruit.
Okay.
Starches are important. Folks trying to gain weight, potatoes, rice, things like that. But I'm a big advocate against going nuts with it. Now, afternoon athlete, right? Have a good breakfast. Mix of carbs and protein, and you want to, if you're going to have some of those quicker carbs like rice, things like that, potatoes, you want those earlier in the day.
Okay.
It's better for the muscle, for your body's performance to have those faster carbs, right? After the training, I generally with folks, if they're trying to stay a little bit leaner, I pull some of those carbs away and we go to a little bit more vegetable based later on in the day. But if they're okay with getting a little bit bigger and they really want to get stronger faster, we keep the carbs in. Cause why? Cause carbs are great for gaining weight.
Right.
It's tremendously helpful.
I've done research on that myself. Carbs gaining weight.
Yeah.
It works.
And talk about the night folks. Cause I want to get into, it's another myth. I know
people who train at night,
trying to say,
don't eat carbs at night, man. Cause you go to bed and then it stays
well,
on you forever.
You want
right?
to try to avoid. So we talked earlier about when we get stronger, when we build muscles, when we sleep, right? If you are that person who late night food means I can't sleep well, and I'm losing my quality of sleep, I can't do that. You can have a shitty diet. If you have a shitty diet and really good sleep, you'll probably outperform the dude who's got like a good diet and shitty sleep almost every time.
Okay.
Because that's, again, if we're trying to get stronger and get bigger, that only happens when we're sleeping.
Yeah. Right. Sleep is at the like base of that pyramid.
Oh, yeah.
Sleep is always at the base of any pyramid.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So for the athletes like that, it's kind of like, all right, well, and so the big rumor is like, well, do I need a protein shake or some casein before I go to sleep? I guess like for the hard gainers, definitely. I think for a lot of other folks, it's like a supplement company grab.
Mm.
You know, there is something there that's fighting muscle wasting, but if you're trying to gain a little bit of weight, so if you're someone who wants to get a little bit stronger and maybe lose some of your definition but not get super doughy, just take some aminos before you go to bed. Because it's going to do a very similar thing what the casein does.
Okay.
Because right, everyone's like, oh, well, the casein, but it's like, dude, it breaks down into amino acids anyway.
Yeah. But and it's like, longer lasting and it'll last me like, through my sleep because those 8 hours.
It's not going like to last 8 hours. There's
that's
no
the selling
the
point,
planet.
Though. I remember right. reading that.
Yeah.
In
no, that's
yeah.
The oh, it'll last the whole time you're sleeping.
And right.
No food breaks down that.
Have a protein shake ready on top of the toilet if you go to pee at 2 a.m. Boom.
Well, you know, so you get like an IV.
Right.
I've heard that
hardwired
too.
Hardwired like, in. Oh. But I mean, yeah, so the biggest truth bomb a lot of folks have to hear is, well, we're going to gain weight. It's very, very, very hard to get stronger without gaining weight. Mm. Your body won't recover as well. And I mean, look at like every strength sport ever. Heavier athletes, move higher loads.
Yeah.
Right. Because mass moves mass. It's just physics.
Yeah.
And they're able to build bigger, right? Bigger, big word there.
Yeah.
Bigger, stronger muscles.
Well, your body is going to add both tissues. You know, your body's not going to be like, all right, let's just keep adding muscle and not add any fat.
Wouldn't that be great though?
It would be great.
There's something that does that. It's called anabolic steroids. Yeah.
So that's the biggest talk to have with folks. Like, if we want to get stronger,
okay, I'm
going to gain some weight.
So that's kind of the macronutrient side of things. How about, like, if we're kind of grouping micronutrients and supplements in the same category? Now let's talk about, okay, what are some of the most vital, like, micronutrients? Like, should you be eating vegetables or just focusing on eating meat and potatoes? Like, what are some good supplements to take? We talked a little bit about the intra, but let's talk about that a little more.
If we're just talking about strength, the most important thing is going to be, like, probably just getting in those, like, enough amino acids to support your growth.
Okay.
That's going to be your biggest thing.
So amino acids, the biggest thing.
I'm a big believer though, also in, if I have an athlete trying to gain strength before we lift, a little bit of creatine, after we lift, a little bit of creatine.
Why?
There's been some studies that just, and I wish I could quote them, I can't remember. There's been some really recent studies that show that the same drive pumping that water in and out of the muscle is equally, well, not equally, but just similarly helpful after the workout to help the muscle recover as it is to help it move in the workout.
Okay.
So there's a new study called, I think it was just like 3 or 4 years ago that came out.
Okay. So aminos are big. So creatine, yeah, before and after, aminos and during and after?
Aminos during, if this is a person trying to gain strength, we're trying to get bigger. Mm-hmm. So now we can have a protein shake afterwards.
Okay.
That is worth looking into for someone.
With, right? Aminos?
No, you don't need double dose like,
okay,
that. You know?
Okay.
And I personally like my athletes to have some carbs after workout, like a carb, so like, mm-hmm, like maxi whey's.
Yeah,
in the shake.
Yeah.
Because we want to get that glucose back into the system to help our insulin.
Yeah.
To help pick up that storage hormone, okay, again.
So what other, anything else besides waxy maize? I know there's just like straight.
It's like dextrose and
dextrose, yeah.
Maltodextrin back in the day. People used to take a lot, but that fucks people's stomachs, right?
I mean, it's sort of a person to person thing.
Yeah.
Just see what works for you.
What I love is some folks will mix, corn, like, if you have a blender, some folks will put like Rice Krispies in there. And it's like, you know, with the protein shake. It tastes good. It works great.
I like that. I've never tried that. Try that.
Rice Krispies work well because they're solid enough that they'll shred. If you use rice, it'll just like get gummy. Mm-hmm. But the Krispies are solid enough that they actually just break down and shred. Or you can like take a coffee grinder, put the Krispies in there, grind them up, put them into the shake.
Mm-hmm.
Great way to save some money too, generally.
Word.
Than buying like these high-end carb sources.
So now how about, and we kind of talked about the dedication to getting stronger and the length of time it's going to take to get stronger, yeah, right? We live in a world where it's like, I want this to happen fast.
I'm going
to
bulk this month, right? Next month, exactly. I'm cutting.
Like, it's a process. You need to be committed. Yep. However, there are a lot of little, when it comes to like weight loss and things, there's like hacks, I guess, for lack of a better word, like, ooh, put cinnamon in your coffee. That'll help with your blood, like things like that.
Yep.
So are there any hacks, I guess you could say, as far as little things you could be doing to increase your chances of gaining strength?
Yeah.
like sleep with your socks on your hands or something like that.
That doesn't work. I've tried that.
It doesn't?
Damn it.
What are some really good ones? Healthy fats are huge. Steroids.
Also part of the healthy fats.
So the one thing I don't want to say is nothing's going to get away from, it's going to take a long time.
Right.
There's nothing to avoid that. But I think the biggest thing I've seen help folks out is just like finding a way to get all those calories in consistently. And I don't have my athletes who are trying to gain strength, like they don't have like rest days from eating.
Right.
Which is something that I
was just going to ask you that.
A lot of folks don't do that. A lot of folks say like, oh, we didn't train today, so don't eat as much.
Yeah, I was just going to, that was going to be my next question. Like, are days you're training different than the days you're not training, that you're completely off?
There's that nutrient time we talked about earlier, that very rudimentary sort of idea of like, mm-hmm, we have to get enough in to get our work in, and then we have to eat after we work out. You don't want to have, if you have that long break after a workout, your body's just going to waste away. It's not going to recover well enough. So you do want to get something, and that's where protein shakes can be good for folks if you're super busy. have something just to get in right after the workout. Mm-hmm. But for the most part, right, if we're thinking about that original caloric idea, I'm trying to spread those calories over multiple days. I want to keep the calories coming. Right. So that we're not...
So even on your off days?
Yeah.
So are you eating the same amount of calories or trying to eat the same amount of calories on days
you
don't lift?
You can take a little bit off because think about this, right? Basal metabolic rate is the body at rest. Mm-hmm. It's not the body at work.
Right.
So if they're not training, there's a certain caloric output we don't need to monitor for anymore that we can pull back from a little bit.
So I like take a meal out on days you don't train?
Probably more
like
a snack. Okay. Maybe make one of the meals smaller.
Okay.
More than take a meal all the way out.
What do you say about like earning your carbs? That's a big thing. Like if you're not training, you're not eating carbs. Like no questions asked.
Yeah, I don't think that's smart.
Especially because like say I'm off. Oh, it's Sunday, but Monday I got a strength session. I got to do a Metcon after.
Right.
I didn't eat any carbs yesterday. It's like, well, like how are you going to make it through Mondays like to fuel next day?
It almost seems like the days you are off are the days you should be slamming carbs and food.
Well, it's that. And it's like, are you a pro athlete or are you a human being? You got like kids and shit, you know, and your life's stressful. Like you still need, you know, we talked about that last time on the podcast, like stress induces a higher carb intake, you know? So if you're a person who's like, a lot of folks screw that up, man. It's like, oh, well, I'm not training today, but I am the chief executive of a Fortune 500 company. And my job is crazy stressful, but no carbs for me because I'm not training today.
I just traveled for a week.
I hate this and I'm quitting training because I hate this. And if we're looking at gaining strength takes years. You can't afford to hate it.
Right.
You can't.
Word. All right. Anything else you want to add on gaining strength?
I'll think of all of it tomorrow. But usually happens. Yeah.
It'll be in overtime.
I'll be like, oh, I should have said like all these other things that I didn't say.
We're just going to go wait at John's house till he has something to say. Turn it on.
What would have been some of your, like, for you personally, what have been some of your, like, successes as far as, hey, this worked for me?
For me?
Yeah.
I mean, I was so fat for so long that when I finally got smaller, I got down. So I was 315. I was huge. I got down to 170.
I was going
to
say there was a point of you were just like shred city.
Yeah, I was 170 pounds. And like right now I'm like 200, 205, 210.
So like in the middle-ish of that.
Yeah, it's totally in the middle between 315 and 170.
Oh yeah, no, that's not in the middle.
It's not close.
But no. Dude, math's just made up, dude. It's what just it, numbers.
What it was, so I was like 170, 180. And Kevin, my coach, was like, hey, you should try gaining weight again. And
you were probably so apprehensive about
it. Dude, psychologically, having to gain weight again was horrifying.
Yeah.
And I was, this is like every meal I ate, I definitely had like some kind of weird eating disorder. Every meal I ate was like steamed chicken or like boiled chicken. Like
nothing tastes better than that. Not one.
Not even like baked or grilled. I would steam or boil my chicken. Was I read that steaming and boiling were like the best ways to cook it for like health. So I was like, oh, I'll just do that. And like, or like canned tuna with like nothing in it. And
perfect.
Then just like spinach with like vinegar or like steamed broccoli with like pepper, no salt, white rice.
I don't want to retain water.
On our next episode, eating for fun with John Durrett.
This is all
sounds
after,
like what the Nazis
but
served.
This is after
like,
the 32 ounce peanut butter endeavor that happened like years before that.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'd had my fun.
it's like in your 20s, like, oh, I partied enough, I'm good.
But what I decided to do was I've always had sort of like a more analytical approach to stuff. I like having systems in place for everything.
Yeah.
And so that's where I developed the idea of, well, what if I add 10% to my food? All right, let me add 10% more. All right, I'm still not gaining weight. What if I change what I'm eating a little bit? What if I get a little more flexible with it? And now, like, every day the same food, but it's like not as horrifying, you know.
Right.
It's like I do baked chicken now with like seasonings on it. Every morning is rice and eggs.
Word.
For the most part. But like,
that's a good combo. That's so an overlooked
get some,
combo.
Get some kimchi in there, man.
Ooh. Shinji. I don't know what that's from.
I thought you were quoting Austin Powers again.
I thought I was. All right. So we're going to wrap it up there. That's Eating for Strength with John Durrett. Definitely going to have this guy back on. You could definitely expect to see him again. Social media, just remind the folks, where can you find this guy?
Simple. It's Johnny Durrett on Instagram.
Mm, yeah.
And then my name on Facebook.
Word.
It's his name.
Word.
His name.
He loves his cats, so you'll see his cats on his Instagram.
It's a cat photo.
Oh, and you're going to get a dog today.
That's
Do you know what type?
Huh?
What type of dog?
So they go. You go to the shelter and they like have a dog that you thought you wanted, mm-hmm. and they're like, but also look at these dogs. So the one where
it's like car salesman.
Yeah. Well, no, because they talk like what do you want in a dog? Yeah. And like, oh yeah, but it's kind of like car salesman.
This dog has XM radio.
But the one we're looking at, the one that we wanted to go see, is part pit bull, part chocolate lab.
Mm.
She's super cute, but I'm a little worried because I'm definitely more of like a cat person.
Yeah, right.
And like, if this dog fucks up my cat, man, I'm taking it out. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's curtains.
Oh, holy shit. No,
if I don't, I think I'll get like my engagement annulled.
Yeah, you'll be fucked. All right, guys, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. Don't forget to subscribe to us on iTunes and whatever it is you do on Stitcher. Leave us a 5-star review.
Figured it out.
And check us out on all of our social media. And we'll see you guys next episode.
Yeah.
Peace.
Thank you, guys.